Daniel Chadwick. Hij woont in het dorpje Stroud in het graafschap Gloucestershire. Dat ligt 2 uur ten westen van Londen. En hij woont er in een alleraardigst pand. U leert ze allemaal kennen. Daniel, zijn vrouw Juliet en de kids. Eva en Casper.
Where are you?
En we nemen u mee naar die merkwaardige pub die hij kocht omdat hij al 10 jaar zonder eigenaar was. En waar wonderbare dingen gebeuren.
We zijn in Lippiet Park. Een eindeloze oprit brengt ons naar een sprookjeshuis. Daar worden we opgewacht door een trio waakhonden. Zij bewaken de kunstwerken in de tuin, gemaakt door de vorige bewoner, beeldhouwer Lynn Chadwick. Die werd na decennia van onopgemerkt ploeteren op latere leeftijd alsnog ontdekt en erkend als groot kunstenaar van internationale reputatie. En als gevolg daarvan werd hij grootgrondbezitter. Als je dit ziet, kun je nauwelijks nog voorstellen dat deze tuin van onmetelijke afmetingen zo'n 60 jaar geleden volkomen verwaarloosd was. En het pand een totale ruïne, rijp voor de sloop. De huidige landlord is Lynn's zoon Daniel Chadwick, die hier opgroeide.
Mr. Chadwick.
Hello.
How was it as a child to live in this house?
Oh, it's amazing. It wasn't quite like this as a child. We lived in a very small part of the house because it was pretty much derelict. And so I remember as a child, we'd discover new bits of the house. There were bits that were...
Where you had never been, probably.
No, never been. And they were boarded up and we'd undo the board and there was this amazing big room just full of dusty...
That you had never seen before.
Never seen. No. We had a lot of that. And of course, people have dreams about that. You know, it's a common dream, isn't it, to go through and find a door. But we really were doing this.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Hier wonen kon de oude Chadwick zich alleen veroorloven omdat het landhuis met bijgebouwen zulke abnormale afmetingen heeft dat het simpelweg te duur was om af te breken. Dat was na de oorlog normaal gesproken wel het lot van dit type landhuizen. Slopen.
That's why he was able to buy it, because people can't quite believe now that, you know, that these were relatively cheap. They were being demolished at a rate of something like 20 per week. It was a giant amount of demolition. And I might have my facts wrong here, but this one actually had a proper scheme of demolitions in place when he bought it. It had been for sale for 10 years. 10 years.
10 years. No one wanted it.
No one wanted it, nothing.
No one even wanted to demolish it.
They didn't. It couldn't be bothered.
Too expensive to demolish it, probably even.
I think it was.
En toch, als je alleen al de hall ziet, blijft het bijzonder dat niet een of andere onroerend goed tycoon zich over het pand ontfermde, maar een beeldhouwer. Maar Lynn Chadwick was zo verliefd geworden op deze plek dat hij er tientallen jaren lang elke cent in stak die hij verdiende. Vandaag de dag verraadt de inrichting de hand van een groot kunstenaar. Lynn's zoon Daniel was engineer, werkte als architect voor hij designer werd. Hij leeft van zijn uitvindingen. We krijgen ze te zien, maar vooral van het maken van dit type mobiles. Die doen tussen de 30 en 250.000 euro. En net als papa Lynn stopt ook zoon Daniel elke cent in het pand. En dan is er dus Chadwick, de uitvinder. Ontwierp een taxi op zonne-energie met veel minder onderdelen dan de huidige en met een uitgekiend formaat wielen. Details volgen. Hij bedacht onorthodoxe backgammonspellen en dat het leuk is om een biljartbal als deurstopper te gebruiken. Je stuit hier trouwens toch op wonderbaarlijke objecten waarvan het nut niet direct zonneklaar is. Maar wat hij zelf beschouwt als zijn levenswerk is toch de eerste pizzaoven voor thuis. Uitgevoerd in goud of zilver. In 3 minuut 37 is de pizza klaar. Niks houtskool, niks vuur, niks megastenen oven, gewoon op gas. Het mooie is dat hij er ook meteen de designprijs van het jaar mee gewonnen heeft. Intussen blijft de vraag, hoe is het toch mogelijk dat vader Chadwick, arm geboren, arm gestorven, dit pand wist te redden van de ondergang?
The obvious question is, how could he as a sculptor, as an artist, afford this? You say it was relatively cheap, but how relative is that?
Well, it was about the price of 4 cottages. So it was
unbelievable.
It was quite a lot, but it wasn't too much.
Het interieur is op veel plekken nog zoals papa het achterliet. Het moet voor hem ook bijzonder geweest zijn om hier zo te kunnen wonen na al die jaren van armoede.
Well, they came from a very middle-class background. His father was a mayor. He'd been totally disinherited by his father, and so he'd lived in poverty.
Een foto onderaan de trap herinnert nog aan de vorige bewoner. Pas op latere leeftijd zou dit ventje Lin dus opeens ontdekt worden als groot kunstenaar. Werd commander of the British Empire en officier in de Ordre des Arts et des Lettres. Maar belangrijker nog, hij ging geld verdienen met zijn werk. Een van zijn beelden, Sitting Couple, staat in Den Haag. Maar toen het pand en de tuin weer zo ver opgeknapt waren dat het land goed leefbaar was, overleed hij 12 jaar geleden.
He bought this house and he borrowed money to do that as well. Well, with a big debt, yeah. A growing debt, and a kind of unrealistic situation.
What a story. Well, what do we see here? Because where do you live mainly here? Because you have the choice. The French would say l'embarras du choix. You can't choose where you want to sit, where you want to be.
Well, we're quite nomadic in a way. We move around the house because sometimes, I mean, it depends really. But we've had to do things to survive here. We live in here in the summer. And we live in there in the winter.
Isn't that fantastic?
It is fantastic. And yet, I do also find that because these big houses, they take so much out of you. You know, they can suck you.
Oh, yeah?
They'll suck all your money.
And your money.
Your money will... Any money you have, it will go. I mean, my father died with no money. Or they had no money at all. It was all in the house. And every money I make, it just... That's where it goes.
Yeah. Was it a dream of his that... His son would take the estate.
It wasn't a dream. It was always complicated because he had three wives and he had a...
At the same time?
Children. I'll come on to that. you know, there was the 60s in there somewhere.
Oh, you say that must have been possible at the time.
Well, in those times, as I was growing up, my father lived at that end and my mother lived at that end and she had... A boyfriend at that end, and my father had a girlfriend at that end, and we all ate together in the
now
middle
I'm with
every
you,
day.
Mr. Chadwick, now I'm with you.
And it was a very civilized arrangement.
Vader Lin wist dat geen van zijn kinderen ervoor voelde om de enorme zorg van het landgoed op zich te nemen, maar hij hield hoop.
I think he hoped it, and the awfully sad thing was that I told him that I couldn't, because I was feeling the stress rising of the responsibility. So I said, okay, I'm really sorry, but I'm not going, you know, I'm going to go off and set my own life up, and which yeah. I did.
Yeah. But he died here. He died in the house, or
he
not?
Died in the room there. Yeah. And as soon as he died, I came back from my house and I saw him. I was back it was only 5 miles away, so I came back and he was dead. And then they tried to take him out of the house in a kind of trolley, you know, with a bag, and they're taking him away. And they were taking him out the door, and I said, no, because he was going to be buried in the churchyard miles away. And I said, no, he can't go. No, he can't go. We must bury him here. And from that point on, I then had to, I realized that by saying that, I'd had to step up to the mark and pull one out of the bag and take it on.
Daniel werkte dus als architect voor die in de voetsporen van zijn vader trad. Die was zijn tijd ver vooruit. Het is duidelijk dat Daniel geïnspireerd werd door wat papa hem liet zien en wat hij van zijn reizen meenam.
When I was a young boy, my father brought these back from South America, these cubes.
Zo waren deze kubussen uit een ver land uiteindelijk duidelijk de inspiratiebron voor hoe Daniel denkt over het backgammonspel. En hij bedacht ook iets waarmee je jezelf even kunstenaar kunt voelen.
Ja. Even kijken hoe dat werkt, dat is prachtig.
Veel belangrijker dus zijn opvatting van hoe een taxi eruit zou moeten zien. Hij kon het allemaal alleen maar bedenken omdat hij en beeldend kunstenaar en designer en engineer is.
The problem with cars is that the cars are sitting in a traffic jam all day and the engine's going and it's having an explosion every time the piston And it's obviously not right. So to make a concept of a taxi car that's electric, so taxis are always sitting around waiting. So it has a... The start point really was a full solar roof. So it's always charging up. If you're not going to go very fast, you don't need to worry about aerodynamics. If you have symmetrical, all four corners are the same. The front is the same as the back. The part numbers are reduced dramatically. A lot of people, when they do electric vehicles, they make little stupid little wheels like a golf buggy, and you see it goes along and it's doing this. And what's the... So I started with the wheel diameter of a Bugatti.
Yeah.
There's a meter. And it's... so it rolls smoothly. The bigger the wheel, the smoother. And it's thin, so it has very, very low rolling resistance.
So this is more or less where you live, or not?
But it is now, yes.
Now. It changes every season, probably.
It was the snooker room.
And this is probably the oven.
Yes, the oven, yes.
But it's gold. I've seen it in silver also.
Yeah. This is a special edition in titanium nitride.
Okay. And you worked 18 years on this one? Not every minute, but
so
it took quite some time.
So far, 18 years, yeah.
Okay.
It's typical of the way I look at all the projects and everything I do in my life. It's an ongoing process.
But it's a revolution in pizza cooking, isn't it?
It is a revolution, yes. What happened was we had a very good pizza in an Italian restaurant from a wood oven. It was fantastic, and it was crispy. It was and somebody said, my friend Mark said, Dan, why can't you make a little one, you know, a little one of those that for home, and we can sell it and become millionaire. If you have a clay oven and you light a fire, it gets to the certain kind of magic temperature, which is somewhere near 400 centigrade.
Yeah.
And your normal oven at home only goes to 250. So I had to do something to get the temperature up.
So that was complicated, wasn't it?
Well, it wasn't that complicated. It was really just having a hole in... a hole. Oh.
Hole it was bottom. Complicated, but you found an easy solution.
The actual gas, instead of just going round the outside of the pan to the ceiling, it's channeled over inside and out of here. Until then, I was treating everything like I treat an art piece, as a one-off. So I've never had any real proper concept of production, repeatability, and also function.
But again, the taste. Does it taste differently from a great pizza?
When you've done it yourself, it's the best. And this has been my most proud achievement, because I know I can leave that in that form.
That's your legacy.
I could leave that.
Yeah.
I could die tomorrow and I'd be quite happy that I'd left something that was finished.
Hoog tijd voor een officiële objectieve test in de keuken, waar de voltallige kitchen staff al in vol ornaat is uitgerukt, de ingrediënten klaar liggen en opeens de deur open gaat.
We needed a...
Oh. Who's this?
This is my wife.
This is your
Juliet.
Wife. Juliet. Hi, Ivo. How are you doing? How about the pizza? Is it okay, the pizza?
Yeah,
because he said it's the best pizza one can have.
It is. Did you make one?
Not right now, but...
I made the dough this morning.
Something... There was no way to get the pizza...
Oh, it's beautiful. He's so proud of this. We've seen so many beautiful things, but this is his legacy, a pizza oven. A man with so many qualities is the happiest with the fact that he created a pizza oven.
Well, no, because it's satisfying.
Isn't that a paradox?
I think it's because he's joined his sense of design together with a product, a functional thing, and it's beautiful, functional, and it makes a lot of people very happy, and it's affordable as well. So I think...
Also, it's finished. You see...
But he's been talking a lot up till now. Maybe it's far too intimate a question, but is it possible to live with a man like this? What's the hard part and what's the nice part?
it's amazing living with him. He's incredible. I've got an artistic sensibility anyway, so he feeds my inspiration and I love living with him.
But you make designs yourself?
I do, yeah.
What's your work exactly?
I'm working on some wallpaper designs at the moment.
And is he criticizing you?
He's very supportive, actually.
Yeah.
I always ask him for criticism, but he's very, very encouraging.
And do you criticize him from time to time, or do you think everything he makes is wonderful and fantastic and amazing?
No, it's very, very important. I really
I was asking Juliet, her.
Well, sorry, I have to interrupt. Juliet does.
You have to interrupt.
I look to Juliet all the time. Oh, is this okay? Is that okay? And she goes, yes, no, yes, no.
And actually, although I'm quite an optimistic person, with having been trained in an art school, I learned to develop my sense of criticism so that you can give constructive criticism to somebody without hurting their feelings. So I use my experience from
Do you recall the moment that you came into this house for the first time?
It was really kind of dizzying, but wonderful. I felt very welcome. I've never felt any sense of feeling, you know, afraid of the
size. It's not frightening.
No, I love it.
It feels like home.
It's very light and lifting, this place.
Despite the fact that you move from one room to another all the time.
Yeah.
Depending on the seasons, I understood.
Yeah. I think it's healthy. To do that.
And how is it for the kids?
They're brilliant. They've had to learn from a very early age how to be aware of sharp metal objects and very high spaces and sheer drops. So physically, they're very capable, which is wonderful.
Intussen kan het niet anders. Of het is hier voor de kids een paradijs.
Pizza.
En de blik van de uitvinder, zijn ega en de inmiddels aangeschoven vrienden staat ook op prima. En dan naar de een paar minuten verderop gelegen pub die Daniel 10 jaar geleden gekocht heeft. Een bijzondere kroeg, want hier gebeurt van alles. Zo zijn hier elke donderdag de Thursday Lunch Insults. Daar wordt iedere bezoeker tijdens de lunch door de barman van dienst zo pittig mogelijk beledigd. Daniel kocht de pub om geen enkele andere reden dan dat het hem irriteerde dat hij al zo lang te koop stond.
Because it was for sale so long that one night, a windy night, we were sitting here and the sign that said for sale fell off. And so I said, okay, I'll do it.
Hier worden ook allerhande verkiezingen gehouden. Zo was er onlangs de verkiezing van beste baard van de regio. Daniel gooide hoge ogen, maar werd niet de uiteindelijke winnaar.
You came third.
I should have won it, really. You have to grow and see how big it is in 3 months.
There were a lot of competitors.
Oh, it's absolutely every single man who from the pub grew a beard. It was fantastic.
And you came third, but people told me he had the best beard.
I did have the best.
Yeah, so it was a diplomatic decision.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
Maybe the women judged it. So the men had to line up and walk through a room full of all the women. And they had very, very many criteria. I don't know what the criteria, what they were, but they had a huge list of things, ticking, 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 points, points.
Juliet maakt dus ontwerpen voor behangmotieven. Bijzonder dat ze elkaar getroffen hebben. Allebei zijn ze creatief, allebei staan ze optimistisch in het leven. Maar ja, hier mogen wonen, dat is natuurlijk ook wel iets. Niet alleen de geest van vader Lynn Chadwick is nog voelbaar, hij is er ook nog.
He had that sternness, that character that people like Roald Dahl had. That very, very, very determined, single-minded person.
Knew exactly what he wanted.
Absolutely, he wouldn't put up with any kind of nonsense. I'm much more friendly and...
Are the door always closing when it starts raining?
That was him.
Oh, that's him, he does it.
En dan nog even terug naar de kamer waar de kinderen van Juliet en Daniel geboren zijn en waar Lynn Chadwick overleden is.
When he was very old, he had his bed here so that he could be near everybody, and he died here. And then both of my children were born
in the same room.
In this room, we made a little swimming pool, a pool. They're both born.
Where do you want to die, also in this room?
I wouldn't mind dying in here, no. If I had a choice. No.